opposition is not our colleagues. The Suprema, like the RNC. Presentation
na.
Pan sa atin po naman kapatan sa festival, marami po pag-usapan ngayon sapagkat may kinalaman po ito sa ginabukasan ng ating bansa. Pinag-uusapan po na isa sa mga solusyon ay ang federalismo upang umunlad ang bayan. Meron po mga nagsasabi na ito na nga ang kailangan at isa ito sa mga campaign promises ni noon ay Davao City Mayor Rodrigo Roa Duterte na ngayon ay Pangulo na ng Republika ng Pilipinas. Ngayong umagang ito, kasama po natin ang ama ng local government ko, si dating Senate President Aquilino Nene Pimentel Jr. Narito rin po naman si Anakpawis Congressman Ariel Casilao, si Kaik, mula po sa Anakpawis, si dating Congressman Dante Liban, okay, so let's begin again. Kasama rin po natin si Attorney Michael Henry Yusingco. Siya po ay isang mananaliksik mula sa Ateneo School of Government. At mahalaga rin ang papel ng kanilang tanggapan sa issue ito because they look at the issues very objectively. Now, let's listen to Senator Nene Pimentel celebrating his 84th birthday today. And this is where he will celebrate his birthday to share with us updates on federalism. Mr. Senate President, narito po yung mikrofon.
Salamat po kayo at sa ating mga kasama po dito. Hindi ko na lang magbitin lahat sapagkat bukas na tayo matapos kung magbitin. So anyway, thank you for this opportunity at ako'y malaki ang aking pasalamat na we're able to be together again, especially for this forum. Sapagkat ako'y naniniwala na yung konsepto ng federalism mahirap paikalan sa buong sambayanan without the help of media. So, this is a very, you might say, it's a golden opportunity. Umiikot ako sa buong bansa trying to explain the, sabi ng mga Tagalog, punong-dulo nitong federalismo para maintindihan ang taong bayan. And therefore, preliminarily, gusto ko lang idagdag na ito ay version ko lang. It does not mean that this is it. Hindi ito taga sa bato. Kahit sa ulo ni bato, wala ito. So anyway, ganun na nga ang preliminary statement.
Thank you very much. Kaik.
Yes, Camila. Pagat. Congress currently has filed joint resolution. Resolution of both houses number 8, filed last August 2016, convening the Constituent Assembly to transform and to change the 1987 Constitution. And part of that resolution of both houses number 8, may propose na doon na amendments to the every article of the 1987 Constitution. At the same time, Congress, through the Committee of Government, Local Government, and Constitutional Amendments, meron pong inihapag ang PDP Laban, isang makapal na proposal as to the proposed amendments of every article. And that is why the committees started to conduct consultations, hindi pa po committee hearings. Consultations, studying every batches of article. Umabot na kami ngayon sa lahat, natapos namin ang lahat ng artikulo and definitely ang committee will present a final draft for possible pag-convena ng both houses.
Are you optimistic that the House of Representatives would have the luxury of time to talk about it?
The problem now, hindi mukhang wala eh. Kasi while the committee is conducting its own constitution, its own consultation and the meetings, but the leadership is more of nasa focus na yun ng impeachment.
So would you say that the House of Representatives' leadership is more focused on extracurricular activities?
Well, they can do multitask naman. Pero sa ngayon, it seems na hinahayaan muna yung committee na gumulong at magkaroon na konsultasyon.
Okay. Thank you very much for that, Dave. Dante, you're also an advocate of federalism. How different is your version from that of Kanene?
May ilang panukala na hindi tugma. But ang masasabi ko ang dahilan niyan kung ano sa palagay ng iba, anong makakabuti. Ang ating samahan, People's National Movement for Federalism, o PENAMPE, is intrinsically a private sector organization. It does not belong to any party, political or sectoral party. It is our hope we will, you know, if I may use the title of your program, tatapatan natin ang hiling at hinaing ng taong bayan sa pagsususog ng ating sariling dagat. So in other words, we have proposals na hindi tugma o hopefully we hope it's an improvement. But I have to give honor to my idol, Senator Nene Pimentel. He has been our inspiration in this movement for federalism. And I'm also honored that on his birthday today, we are part of this
discussion.
Special event.
Of course.
Okay, thank you.
Cake is forthcoming, don't worry. Attorney Yusingco, you come from the Ateneo School of Government. They say that in the Philippines, once you write a book, by the time it gets published, the scenario has already changed because alliances change, just like changing shirts. How is it?
First of all, good morning to everybody and to all the guests here in the panel. Good morning as well. I think our book is a deviation from that rule because our book is essentially a citizen's handbook. So it's as you said earlier, we try to be as objective as we can in analyzing what federalism is. So, our book is, in a way, timeless. And besides, it's going to be launched on Thursday. I distributed flyers to the members of the press here in case anyone is interested. You're welcome, of course, to attend. And not a coincidence, Senator Nene will also be our distinguished speaker there. And Melo, you will be the MC, I believe. So
I was tasked to be the moderator.
So the book is a citizen's handbook. It doesn't promote any model in particular, whether it's the PDP or Senator Nene. It's aimed to help Filipinos understand ideas relating to federalism.
Okay, now let me ask you. I've heard of arguments from some other people. Notably, Christian Monson. He said, why go federalism when we haven't exhausted everything within the local government code? What are your thoughts about it?
This is just my humble opinion. The reality is, the option to federalize is now before us. Whether we like it or not, the president has put that on the table. So we might as well discuss it, analyze it, find out if this is right for us. I don't think it's right to just dismiss the question by saying, why do we need to federalize when we haven't utilized the 1987 Constitution? That's a valid point for sure. But the reality is, the option to federalize is now on the table. So we might as well engage the discussion and then find out if this is really the right fit for us.
Okay. Yes, Senator Nene. Yes, please.
Yun ang nga ang sinasabi nila. Ba't naman hindi na lang gawin yung expand ng local government code Mga kababayan, nung ginawa namin yung local government code, linagyan ko ng provision that every 5 years, when the code is adopted, dapat i-review, titingnan ng Kongreso. My goodness, 25 years almost na, tapos they have never done it. Therefore, are we going to allow the highly concentrated system of government that we now have to continue in the light of recent events? For example, when Samar and Leyte were hit by
typhoon,
Yolanda, sino ang namudmod ng pera doon sa mga biktima? Si Dinky Soliman. Now, hindi ko binabanata si Dinky by mentioning your name. Just,
perspective.
It's a matter of record.
Perspective.
And who was Dinky Soliman at the time? She was the head of the Department of Social Welfare and Development. An agency which has been devolved to local government units. Mm-hmm. Meaning to say, kapangyarihan, pundo, personnel ng DSWD, nalipat na. Mm-hmm. Ang intention ng local government code, ilipat yan sa mga gobyerno lokal. Sinubod ng mga pera sa mga biktima. Kaya ang mga gobernador doon, mga mayor local government, medyo galit at narinig ko ang kanilang kumplen na ba't naman hindi kami mas kilala namin ng mga tao apektado nitong Yolanda ito, ba't sila pa rin? Meaning to say, by and large, parang reluctant talaga ang gobyerno nasyonal na to let go of the levers of power, mm-hmm. even in the face of what the local government code has already mandated.
Okay, very valid point. Kadante, kayo po, ano yun na lang?
Yeah, sa tanong mong why federalism, why now? Okay. Among the panelists, I think I can say that I'm the only one who had been with the president when he was running for president. In most all campaign sorties, Luzon besides Mindanao. And he's the only candidate who publicly, boldly espoused for federalism. Siya lang talaga eh, ang latarang nagpanukala. At kung idadagdag mo dyan, Melo, ang resulta ng halalan, one could say that he has the support or mandate of the people for his all-out bold advocacy for federalism. So, yun ang idadagdag ko lang from the political perspective, Melo, no? Mm-hmm. Na he was the only one who openly, boldly espoused for federalism. The other presidential candidates hardly said anything. And with support, mandate from the people, in a way you can say that the people are behind him on this matter.
Okay,
federalism.
Very good. Kaya, kayo po ay nasa Kongreso, hindi po kaya isang dahilan kaya hindi makausad ang federalismo sa mababa at sa mataas na kukuluman, eh sapagkat apektado ang political dynasties in the local government units.
Well, malamang isang reality yan. Ano? Natatakot yung mga kasama ko sa Kongreso. Ang mga proposal kasi na inihapag kami, no, una, dito sa RBH number 8, 18 regions, ang federal states. Doon sa discussion with the PDP Laban proposal, sa Luzon, 3 or 4 lang. Sa Visayas, 2. Sa Mindanao, 3. No, hindi pa kasama doon ang BBL. Yung ano yung territory ng ARMM, expanded territory ng ARMM after the BBN. So, ito yung mga draft proposals na siyempre yung mga kasama ko sa Kongreso na may mga political territories din yan. Maapektuhan yan. Kaya nga, ngayon, sa tingin ko, talagang hindi pa umuusad yung final na konsepto. Ano yung tatalakayin collectively ng Kongreso? Dahil nga meron pang maraming mga tanong na hindi pa nasasagot. Kasasakuyan, inahapag ngayon ang BBL. Umusad na yung BBL. 3 committee ang nakatokan yan. Pero magre-recess na kami ngayong December 15. So, definitely by next year pa yan. Kung titignan mo yung timeline na proposal ng RBH number 8 and the PDP proposal, supposedly isasabay na ito sa 2019 election. Pero hindi mo makikita yung objective conditions dahil hindi pa nga umuusad. Hindi pa umuusad dito sa level ng House, no, as a collegial body. Sa committee, mayroong mga consultation. Pero kung kailan ba nila maipipresent yung final draft proposal, ay wala pang, sa tingin ko, I don't know with the leadership kung may knowledge na sila. Pero bagamat na naisalin ito sa, naisama ito sa priorities ng Congress, ng 17th Congress, 2018, papasok na tayo ng 2018. Pero wala pang yung makikita mong medyo malinaw na na-proposal.
Wala pa. Mayroon. Okay. Kanan eh. Yes, please.
Tungkol sa political dynasty, ganito ang problema natin. Sa kasalukuyang constitution, ang sinabi doon, political dynasties are prohibited in accordance with law. Ang ibig sabihin noon, kailangan magpasa muna ng batas para mapigilan ang political dynasties. E sino ang magpasa ng batas kung kontrolado ng mga warlords of dynasties dyan ang mga institutions of our legislature? Therefore, when we amend the constitution, because hindi naman po pwede na gawin mo lang yung federalismo by ordinary law, you have to revise the constitution. Pag-revise mo ng constitution, idagdag mo na yung provision that political dynasties are banned. Spell it out. Gobernador, mayor, o sino dyan, presidente, ang anak, ang asawa, babae, pamangkin, up to what civil degree are prohibited from succeeding to a, you might say, a an elected public official.
So,
now, I want to add that ang narinig ko na version sa Senado, up to the fourth civil degree daw ang kanilang pipigilin. Meaning to say, up to first cousin.
Mm-hmm.
So, yun ang go natin.
Pero lusot po yung kirita dahil walang relasyon.
So,
yung kirita.
Kaya nga, you spell it out.
Hindi mo pa spell it out. Hindi, walang relasyon legal.
No, kaya nga, dito sa pangalan nito, sa Constitution, spell it out mo na. Official anak niya, babae niya, or whatever.
Eh, yung lalaki.
Mistress, lalaki niya, whatever.
Okay.
So, in other words, spell it out para maliwanag.
Okay, Kadante, ano po pananaw niyo?
Pagdating sa political dynasty, tama si Kanene, na it should never be subjected to a provision which includes subject to congressional action. It must be self-executing. So that constitutional provision must be self-executing, no need for any law to be enacted. And that is one of our proposals. But the deeper question is this, Melo. Sa present Congress, do you think it will be easy to pass a law banning family and political dynasty? Mm-hmm. Or even including in the proposed constitution? Kasi, nabagod mo kanina, constitutional assembly. I think, my dear friend, assembly. Sa paglilibot ko, Luzon, besides Mindanao, ang People's National Movement for Federalism, pala yung tanong, is it con us or con? Kasi kung con us daw, with your respect, I mean, congressman si Kanene, naging senador, as if we are wishing for the moon. Because no ordinary congressman, I said, or legislator, would adopt a provision that would against that interest. But if a con is conducted, he said, of course, may mga issue against con, the time, the cost, and everything. But we talk about rights and freedom, liberties of our people. Money should be secondary. After all, we are preparing for the future. Kaya, ang issue political dynasty opens a can of many important issues.
But you will agree with me, Kadante, as a former congressman that you are, will that constitute constituent assembly not open the floodgates to other amendments to the constitution? Or will we have to be very specific that we will just limit our revision of the constitution to certain provisions?
Alam mo, Melo, practical ha. I've been there for 9 years. Any agreement among legislators can still be set aside for practical reasons or personal reasons. But if it's a concon is conducted, it is the people who put the candidates there. And they're not beholden to anybody except to the interest, welfare of the people. And it's their future.
Attorney Yusingco, coming from the outside world, do you think this is realistic?
Which one? The CONAS or?
The CONAS. That it will be able to establish and do something good for the country?
That's a very difficult question to answer. But let me put it this way. Let me put it this way. Once Congress declares itself as a constituent assembly, we should remember that they are exercising sovereignty. They are exercising the sovereign power of the people for the particular task of drafting the constitution. What does that mean? It means they can do anything they want. And the only check is the people in the plebiscite. Either to reject what they offered or to ratify what they offered. But during the CONAS process, they can do everything they want. Hence, it's very important, and we should fight for it in case CONAS is the mode of revision that is chosen, that the procedures or the process of the writing process must be transparent. The people must have direct and active participation in the writing process.
Yeah.
And we should insist on that. We should fight for that.
Without sounding centennial, I was in high school at the time when the Constitutional Convention was called for in the Manila Hotel. Meron pang kapo yung mga aktivista sa labas na. Yung grupo ng Students United Crusade for Constitutional Reforms. Tama, no? I still remember. So, yung mga estudyante, ini-engage yung mga delegates. At magandang makinig sa mga debate. Lalo na with the likes of, well, the late Bonnie Hiliego, Pablo Trillano III, and several others, no? Pero, I don't see the kind of personalities now, the Senate. How would you expect? Well, not necessarily putting the card before the house. Okay. Yes, Kananet.
Well, alam natin there are three ways of revising the constitution. First is by constitutional convention, meaning to say election, buong sambayanan. Magsisisi yon. Then constituent assembly, the two houses of Congress will revise the constitution, which is apparently what the government is now pushing for. Then the third is people's initiative.
People's initiative.
Which is, hindi na pinag-usapan yun sapagkat kahit may people's initiative, for example, in Caloocan, at tinanggap ng buong sambayanan, let us revise the constitution pursuant to the recommendation of the people's initiative from Caloocan. Pag matalo sa isang distrito, tapos na yan. In other words, it has to be unanimous. Therefore, parang nakikita nila na it's by constituent assembly. Now, ang importante rito sa Constituent Assembly, huwag pabayaan ng taong bayan na sila lang ang mga congressmen at mga congresswomen at senators will be the only ones who will decide. Dapat mag-participate sila sa mga public hearings. Now, in that connection, dapat ang suggestion ng taong bayan, mag-conduct kayo ng public hearings sa buong Pilipinas, huwag lang sa Manila. Dapat umikot kayo doon sa mga liblib na lugar to give a chance to people para marinig ang inyong boses. Otherwise, yun na nga, your fear can become a reality, you see? Na sila na lang ang magpasya anong gawin dito sa salikang batas na inamin.
Opo, Kaye, matanong kita. Meron pa panukala ng revolutionary government. Kung bigla, i-declare yung revolutionary government by presidential fiat. Inapolis mo yung saligang batas, sabihin ni Pangulong Digo, ito na, gagawa tayo ng bagong saligang batas, tuloy-tuloy ng federalismo. Ano dating sa'yo?
First of all, before I answer that, Camelo, I fully agree with Manong Nene's proposal. Dahil nga mukhang sa malaking porsyento, tutulak na itong RBH number 80 on us na. And President Duterte has already and repeatedly said na mas gastos yung CONCOM. So kailangan na, although meron ding hindi malinaw na sinabi si Presidente Duterte, he will appoint 25 individuals na uupo bilang conscience ng CONAS to present proposals coming from the people. This is a multi-sectoral representation but wala nang sumunod na balita doon eh, kung sino ba ang in-appoint, nakakaharapin ng CONAS na magiging parang consultants na maghahapag ng mga rekomendasyon. But one of the safety measures din na po pwedeng sabihin natin na Cabello, yung proposal ni Manong Nenek na obligado dapat ang both houses to conduct consultation nationwide to hear out directly from the people what they wanted doon sa mga pagbabago ng ating konstitusyon. Pero now, pumapasok itong REPGOV. The danger is the REPGOV wants to propose that all powers be given to the President. Legislative, executive, and even judiciary. Dahil wala nang papel itong Kongreso, ang Kongreso. Let the President create laws like presidential decrees na nangyari noong panahon ng martial law. Ito yung proposal. Tanggalin lahat ng mga prohibitionist provision ng Constitution. I-open up ang ating national economy to 100% ownership. Foreign and both foreign doon sa ating land resources, natural resources. Then, i-enact ni Presidente Duterte na ito na lang ang magiging federal state. Ito yung form of government in accordance to the proposal to be presented by the President. I-enact niya through a presidential decree, ito na yung federal form of government. Walang election ng 2019, probably ang general election will be 2025.
Okay. Ngayon, sa revolutionary government, without necessarily putting...
Okay, sa mga tayo
yan. Sige nga po.
Yeah. Para sa akin, kalokohan yan, ha?
Alam mo kalokohan?
Kalokohan, yung revolutionary government na proposal. Alam niyo kung bakit?
Bakit po?
Sapagkat hindi po basta-basta makapag-deklara ang Pangulo kasi, oy, revolutionary government na tayo. Sapagkat unlike the situation before when martial law of Marcos was the prevailing, you might say, law of the land, you could not question yung deklarasyon ni Marcos noon. Eh, kaya nga ako, apat na beses na naman kinulong sapagkat masyado akong maingay noon. Pero, ang ibig ko sabihin, dito ngayon, the Constitution provides na kung merong mga revision na gustong gawin ni President Digong, dadaan sa Kongreso yon. At ang mga tao, kung ayaw nila na yung sistema yon, they can challenge the action of the executive department and even of the legislature through the courts. No. Which was not possible before, you see? Ang gusto kong sabihin na yung mga sinasabi revolutionary government, even if mayroon diyang isang abogado nagsabi, kailangan natin ito para mas madali ang pag-adapt ng federalismo. He forgets that the end never justifies the means.
You're not referring to Attorney Lali Gadon, no? Yes, kanate.
Well, just to be fair with the President, di ba, sinabi niya, pagdating sa REPGOV, maliwanag sinabi niya, wala na sa kanya yan. Gagamitin niya rin powers niya kung lupay-pay na ang gobyerno. I think, kahit sinong Pangulo, gagawin niya yung kung lupay-pay na. Pero maliwanag sinabi niya na isang tabi na ang REPGOV. So, that's good news for those who are advocating for federalism. Yeah, I think we're put back to the right path now.
Okay. Kai, somebody saying magkakaroon ng special session on the BBL. You know, sabi nila pag may special session, parang may ano, yung tunog ng cash register. Ding.
Camelo, ang natanggap namin ngayon lang is the letter from the President who wants to extend martial law. According to the calendar of activities, hindi kaya matalakay within Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. most probably ang special session is 14 or 15 to discuss ang sole subject matter is whether to extend or not martial law. Na may proposal ang Senate na magkaroon muna ng security briefing. Kami naman sa Kongreso.
Meron yata security briefing
kanito. Kami naman sa Kongreso, hindi pa namin alam kung after the Senate kami na susunod, then magpatawag na naman ng joint session. Whether or not, kaya ba yan may Tuesday or Wednesday, I don't know. Pero most likely, sinabihan na kami ng leadership, standby for possible special session on the 14th or the 15th. Pero with regards to BBL, ongoing yung committee hearing ng tatlong committee. Hindi siguro kailangan na magkaroon ng special session kung hindi pa tapos yung deliberation at wala pang committee report. Unfortunately, nasa unang YouTube pa lang nagpagtalakay ng BBL ng tatlong committee.
Anong problema ng okay. BBL?
Sige po. Yeah.
Ito yan. Pinag-aralan ko yung BBL na yan at bagamat maganda ang layunin. Sapagkat huwag naman sana ma-interpret ng ating mga kapatid na Muslim na ayaw natin yung BBL. Maraming depekto sa BBL. Ang ibig kong sabihin, for example, pagdating doon sa government sa Bangsamoro entity, ang BBL nagsabi na ang pipiliin ng mga leader doon, only those who will belong to the legislative department. And the legislative department will now elect who will be the executive department. That is against our constitution. Sapagkat lahat ng mga official who are elective officials are elected directly by the people. So how can it be done by a sheer law like the BBL? They will revise the constitution unwittingly perhaps. Ano? Kaya na, maraming defecto. Nakita ko rin, BBL. Tinignan ko yung kuha nila. Pangalan nito, Bangsamoro, parang constitution doon. Sinasabi, freedom of speech is recognized. Pero wala yung freedom of speech and of the press, which is provided for by our constitution. Ang ibig sabihin, freedom of speech lang, salita na salita ka, pero hindi ka pwedeng mag-publish freely under the BBL. Ha? Kaya nga, ang sabi ni Presidente, kung yung BBL na yun, isali na doon sa pag-uusap tungkol sa federalismo.
Okay.
Not that we are against BBL, but let us make it so that it will conform with the requirements of our constitution.
Yeah. Ang problema kasi doon, kung wala kang freedom of the press, baka mauwi tayo doon sa AGM ng MMDA, magpapareho ng media na hindi magandang balita tapos sa MMDA, no? Nagpapatawa, pero hindi nakakatawa yun. Pero katulad po nito, kung magkakaroon ng Constituent Assembly at yun ang direksyon, anong safeguards na hindi magkakaroon ng mahiwagang sobre tulad ng naganap noong panahon sa 1971 Constitutional Convention na mayroong pinasikat na pangalan ni Mr. Quintero ng Leyte. No? Ano, nakikita niyo safeguards doon? We have to learn from history. Because Santayana was quoted as saying, who never learns from history will be doomed to commit the same mistake. Kadate, ano po ba nanaw niyo? Kasi attorney, matanong natin.
Alam mo, Melo, alam mo, mga legislators natin, generally, mga practical yan. What I mean is, basta walang di sila masasaktan, they will support. Lana ko may sobre pa. Okay, pampagana yun, no?
Oo.
Kaya,
vitamina.
Oo. Kaya nga, ulitin ko lang, nung kami nangangampanya ni Mayor Digong na President, the record shows that may nagtatanong sa kanya what form, what procedure to revise. If my memory serves me right, in many ways he said, it should be the constitutional convention. No, I thought that was his covenant to the people. Kaya siya binoto among others, di ba, no?
Uh-huh.
Oh, kaya sana pag-aralan mabuti ito. Kasi if you have now a survey of the people now, at pasensya na, brad, tayo nandiyan sa Kongreso, do you trust our legislator
to revise the constitution, there must be a survey. If the survey shows it is they're not for con us, I think the leadership should be guided accordingly.
Okay.
Hindi ba? Fair lang yun, di ba?
Okay. Okay. But let me warn the good gentleman from Quezon City, surveys can also be bought, because if we look at the surveys, lahat ng istasyon ng radyo sa Manila ay number one.
Wala pong anak doon din. Okay, okay. Wala pong nakita sobre doon na.
Okay po, okay po. You don't react. Yes, attorney.
So, the safeguards are applicable to both CONAS and CONCON. First, the writing process must be, or the rules governing the writing process must be published beforehand so that the people will know how the constitution is being drafted. That has to be published beforehand. Secondly, the consultations that will be conducted all over the country, again, must be open to the public, particularly open to the media. And third, which is an innovation because of the internet, the CONAS or the CONCON must have a website that publishes or posts updates of the writing process, so that even if you're a Filipino and you're not here, you're overseas, you can have access to what's happening in the writing process. And that's very important. And not only just the process being published online in the website, but they must also have the ability to comment on what's happening, make suggestions, make reveal what they know about what's happening.
And that will also be very inclusive. That will include the trolls.
That's the freedom of the press, that freedom of expression. So that comes with being free.
Let's go to money matters. They say that once you have federal states, these federal states may not be as financially viable as the progressive regions like NCR, Region 3, and Calabarzon. So what chances has the ARMM or Bicol region got?
Here's how we should look at that. Sure, there are inequalities right now. I mean, that's a given fact that there are inequalities between provinces and regions. But you can't blame that, or you can't use that as an excuse not to shift to a federal form of government. In fact, shifting to a federal form of government requires you to look for solutions to that kind of problems. So in the draft of Senator Nene, he proposes an equalization fund. So that is one method or one mechanism that addresses that kind of a problem. So I don't recommend saying that our inequalities right now should be a hindrance to a shift to a federal form. In fact, shifting to a federal form of government should address that kind of a problem.
Okay, Kaneme.
Yeah.
Ano po yung patala?
Ang punto mo na kung mag-gray tayo ng federal state, merong mga areas na hindi nila kayang to develop their own community on their own resources. Tama po yun. For example, Samaranlege. Ikumpara mo ang Samaranlege sa Cebu, Bohol, etc. Malayo sila. Kung pabayaan mo, siyempre, they will not be able to survive being a federal state. Pero, pag-adapt mo ng federalismo because you are revising the constitution, isingit mo na rin lang doon ang isang provision that there shall be a loan commission, an equalization fund to be run by a loan commission. Para, you remember nung bago tayo naging independent, we used to run to the World Bank and the IMF para magkaroon tayo ng pera na makapag-develop sa ating sarili. Itong equalization fund ngayon na pinapropose ko, atin ito, it is not a foreign body, but an agency to be created also when we revise the constitution. Idagdag na yon equalization fund to be run by a loan commission kung saan ang mga various federal states, 12 yung aking proposal, makatakbo pag kailangan nila ng pundo for their own development.
Kanine, meron pong programa ang gobyerno at ngayon yung mukhang makakalusot na sa Senato. Ito po yung tax reform and acceleration and inclusion, ito yung train. Now, some people say with the train getting to be enacted into law will further strengthen the central government. So how will this fit with our moves for a federal system?
Well, number one, siguro, these are a little bit complicated issues. But let me just say that sa federalismo na aking pinaproposa para maliwanag ito, labindalawa. So, lima sa Luzon, Northern Luzon, Central Luzon, Cordilleras, then Calabarzon, and Bicol. Lima. Metro Manila will remain as the federal capital. It will not be treated as a federal state. Pareho Washington DC, hindi naman federal state yun. Kuala Lumpur is not a federal state. Pagdating sa Visayas, Eastern Visayas, one federal state, Central Visayas, second federal state, third federal state is the Ilonggo provinces. And the fourth federal state, importante itong Ilong. Palawan, Romblon, Mindoro, at Marinduque. Bakit? Sapagkat ngayon, because of the imperialist thinking of some people in Manila, itong region na ito, kinukonsider na part of Luzon. How can it be a part of Luzon? Tinindan ko ang mapa, nandun naman sa karagatan ng Visayas. And therefore, it is better to create it as a federal state of the Visayas. Pagdating sa Mindanao, tatlo. Northern Mindanao, from the tip of Surigao, all our tip of Zamboanga, all the way up to Surigao, medyo mahaba. Which means that pwede yung i-divide, but for purposes of our discussion, huwag na muna. So that it will not complicate the situation. Then, pangalawa, federal state of Mindanao is Southern Mindanao. That's where Davao, Cotabato, that's also another huge area, which may be divided. And the third, in Mindanao, very important, mga kapatid, ha, is the Bangsamoro Federal State. Napaka-importante. At, well, siguro, sabihin nyo, kasali na sa pag-ibang ito, but I am probably the only living politician who was ex-politician, hindi na ako politiko ngayon. Who have
was a politician, always a politician.
Spoken with Normie Suari. Pinuntaan ko si Nor nung nakatago na nasa Saudi Arabia pa siya. And I convinced him, uwi ka na Nor. Because dapat pag-usapan natin itong peace effort natin sa bansa po natin. Puro tayo mga Pilipino, hindi kailangan magpatayan po tayo. So to make a long story short, na-convince si Nor, pumunta siya. But unfortunately, ang peace effort at that time, natigil lang because ang aking participation anyway because tumakbo ako bilang senador and Maning Pelais, former vice president, took over. But hindi nagwagi yung kanilang pangungusap ni Nol. But anyway, I talked with him. I talked with Salamat Hashim, the founder of the MILF. Nor was the founder of the MNLF. Salamat Hashim, MILF. Pinuntaan ko siya sa hideout niya doon sa Simoy, doon sa may bandang Cotabato, on top of a hill. And I remember na yung hideout niya, di mo makita from above because tabunan ng mga
last
tao.
Last green.
But merong anti-aircraft doon sa tabi ng bahay niya just in case na merong maligaw na aeroplano, talagang barili nila. That is how determined they are. I also talked with Haji Murad, itong kuhan na yun, because he was the chief of staff of Salamat Hashim at that time, and we talked at the Simoy Junction. To the last man, including the high mga imams ng Muslim religion, political leaders, activists, to the last person, ang kanilang suggestion is, yes, let us adopt a federal system.
Okay.
Kung saan, eh, putang dito, huwag ko mo nang madali, ha?
Dilma.
Sabi niya, salamat Kasim sa akin nung nag-usap kami. Dinala niya ako doon sa balkonahe niya. At symbolically, tinuro lang niya, kahit doon lang, Senator, basta meron kaming lupa na maituturing na amin talaga kung saan ang aming kultura at tradisyon mabigyan ng sapat na recognition ng mga the rest of the Filipino nation, okay na sa amin yan. Hindi na tayo magkakagulo. You see? Where their culture and tradition will be respected. Therefore, sabi ko sa kanila, pero may mga kultura lang na kinopya ninyo doon sa Middle East na hindi pwedeng ating sundin dito. For example, babae mabuntisan na kung hindi niya asawa, binabato yan hanggang mamatay. We cannot allow that because that would be cruel and unusual punishment na hindi po dapat paintulutan sa ating salinong batas at hindi naman pinapaintulutan. Pangalawa, yung magnanakaw, pinaputulan ng kamay dito sa elbow. Sa isip ko na ako, kadami ng mga tao ng palakad-lakad, palikot sa kongreso, wala na. Joke lang. But the essence is that there are certain practices sa Muslim religion which we cannot adapt.
Okay.
At payag naman sila na merong kompromiso. Therefore, I am kaya nga, buhay pa nga siguro ako, parang may tulong talaga itong, may sulong talaga itong federalism nito.
Okay. I remember a good friend, Mr. Marahom Salim. He was once a commissioner of the Commission on Human Rights. We asked him about his views of getting the Sharia law implemented in the Philippines, where stoning to death is a punishment. And the answer was, we cannot do that in the Philippines. Why? We will run out of stones. Anyway, meron po ba pagmungkahe na isama dun sa federal system, yung Sabah, yung parts of Borneo? Wala kayong mungkahe ganun, Dante, na isama yun dahil
pangin ng Pilipinas. Sa aming usap-usapan, sa People's National Movement of Federalism, we're proposing 18 federal states.
18.
Using the existing administrative regions. Pagdating sa BBL, we're proposing to have two. One BBL in the mainland, Muslim Mindanao, and the second BBL is island, Mindanao. Ngayon, one of our officers suggested, in the event, why don't we put a provision that Sabah, hopefully someday, will be
part of the
Philippine territory. So it's part in our proposal, which we will submit to the President, the draft constitution, to Senate President Coco, to Speaker Bebot Alvarez, and the committee of both Senate and the House.
Okay. May I call on our colleagues from the media who may have questions to please raise your hand and identify yourself. I will recognize you anyway. Let's start. The questions from our colleagues from the media, we can hear you. Do we have questions from the media? Pat? Wala pa.
Sige, tuloy tayo. Gusto kong idagdag na rin lang ito, na sa aking proposal, we are now talking only of Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao for purposes of facilitating the discussion. But, dapat maintindihan ng taong bayan na Sabah is ours. Atin po yun. Bakit? Historically, ang Sabah binigay ng Sultan of Brunei sa Sultan of Sulu. Nung tinulungan ng Sultan of Sulu, ang Sultan of Brunei to repel their enemies. 14th century, patakang layar. At as a matter of fact, Melo, ang may dagdag ko nilang yan, fast-tracking the events. Nung there was an enterprising Austrian businessman, Peter Den at si Baron Overbeck. Dalawang mga tao yan, na nagpunta doon sa Sultan of Sulu at humiling sila ng paintulot na i-develop nila ang Sabah. To make a long story short, nag-agree ang Sultan of Sulu pero bayaran sila ng pangalan ito ay least compensation of the equivalent of $75,000 a year. Malaki yun kung titingnan mo, pero marami naman ang magdi-divide noon. Kaya mas mahal pa ang kondominium sa Makati ngayon kaysa doon sa $75,000 a year na gusto ibayad ng Sultan of, Baron Overbeck and Peter Ten to develop Sabah. Now, to make a long story short, we became independent in 1946. Malaysia became independent in 1948. Paano na pasok ang Malaysia sa pag-usapan natin? Because si Peter Ten at saka si Baron Overbeck, nung tapos na nila mag-develop ang Sabah, bawi na nila yung investment, sinurrender pa naman nila yung kontrata nila with the Sultan of Sulu. Not to the Sultan of Sulu, but to the British Empire.
Mm-hmm.
And the British Empire was the colonial master of Malaysia at that time. So, ang nangyari, nung naging independent ang Malaysia, binigay ng British Empire ang mga papeles doon sa pangalan nito sa Malaysia. Kaya tinuturing ng Malaysia ngayon na sila ang may-ari ng Sabah. Pero kung may-ari ka ng Sabah, magbabayad ka ba ng renta? Melo, ha? So that is one thing na gusto kong isulong na huwag kalimutan sa ating mga taong bayan na Sabah is ours, Scarborough atin ko yun. Hindi ko pwede na mag-nine dash line at China, sabihin nila, part na ng China yung Scarborough. Kung ganun, mag-drawing din tayo 10 dash line para kusin atin yun. And then, Benham Rice.
Yeah, it's ours.
Atin yun. Meaning to say, itong mga bagay na ito, binanggit ko, na huwag kalimutan ng taong bayan para mapanatag ang ating kalooban na ang Pilipinas, hindi lang Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao. Scarborough, Palatag, Kalayaan Islands, Benham Rice, at yung Sabah nga, atin po yun.
Okay, very well. Tama na. Yes, please.
Yes, Ramiro from the Catholic
Virgin Network. Teka, may camera sa likod. Pakisuloy lang po. Pakiatras na po. Yan. Yeah. Okay. Okay, yan.
My question has something to do with the service that you have been undertaking, Representative Dante, and as you go around the country. In your perspective, in your study, in your feel of the people, especially people from Congress like Representative Ayala, ano ang sentiments ng tao regarding federalism? And how do they view federalism? Because right now, it seems that the discussions on federalism remain on the level of the head as far as people are concerned. Pero as far as actual participation and representation of people are concerned, how do they view it?
Overall, bilang katugunan, no? The people are really calling for real change. Kaya yung federalism advocacy effort is a big part of that. Now, I agree with you, kailangan pang itaas ang antas ng kaalaman ng taong bayan at appreciation ng taong bayan. Pero tumataas ito. At gustong-gusto yan ng pagbabago talaga. Maliwanag yun. Ngayon, pagdating sa pagbabago ng ating salikang batas, sa aking paglilipot, gustong-gusto nila yung constitutional convention. Alam mo, meron, wala akong duda na papaset to eh. Given the high popularity rating of the president, pag in-endorse niya yan, I'm sure yung worry ng iba na matagal, no? Magagawa yun eh. The elected Hong Kong delegates, I'm sure given inspired by the president with the support of the people, they will even fast track it. Ang pinakamalaga, this is the handiwork of the people, not by, you know, the sitting legislators right now.
Given your response, how do you intend to reconcile the proposal of Senator Nene regarding having 12 regional representations and yours, which is 18 plus 2 is 20. How do you... because we're supposed to be more than 18 regions as a provincial network or whatever. And then what about the other islands who are not part of the...
Okay, bilang sagot lang, meron, brief lang, no? Ang proposal namin, basically, retain the existing administrative regions and convert them into regional government or state government, plus yung BBL. Ang part of that proposal is we must never abolish a constitutionally created autonomous region like CAR. We are unanimous, we must retain CAR. Small as they may be, but you know, we have to respect that, and the arm. Yun ang aming proposal. Kaya, of course, once you have the body, whether it's con or con us, I'm sure the dynamics will emerge, will come out with a set of federal states in the end.
Yeah. Okay, very well. Kana na.
On that issue, ang proposal ko nga, there shall be only one federal state of the Bangsa Moro, covering the Moro provinces in mainland Mindanao and the offshore Muslim provinces, Basilan, Sulu, Tawi-Tawi. Now, we have to realize, however, that ang mga, in general, mga Muslims in mainland Mindanao, iba ang pananaw nila sa mga Muslim din sa offshore Mindanao. Kausap ko yung Sultan of Sulu bago namatay. Sabi niya sa akin, yung BBL, ayaw namin yun. Sabi ko, bakit Sultan? Sapagkat gusto nilang palitan ang pangalan ng Sulu si Bangsang Moro si. Hindi ko may papayag dyan. Sabi niya, so sabi ko, bakit? Because mawala ang aming identity. Kaya nga kami tinatawag Suluk, S-U-L-U-K, meaning people of the waves. Pagkatapos palitan mo Bangsa Moro, say, hindi pwede po yun. So there are nuances of differences that we as a Christian people must understand. That in dealing with the Muslim, so-called Muslim problem in Mindanao, hindi basta-basta na magpasya ka na lang. So my suggestion is, one federal state, but two autonomous regions. Autonomous region for Muslim Mindanao in mainland Mindanao, autonomous region for Muslim Mindanao, Basilan, Sulu, and Tawi-Tawi.
Very good. How will the Senate look like under a federal system?
Senate?
How will the Senate look like?
Isa sa malaking revision sa ating salitang batas when we adopt the federal system is that ang aking proposal, ang mga senador, huwag na piliin nationwide. Dapat piliin sila by federal state. At of course, ang advantage nito, mas kilala ng mga tao ang kandidato for a particular Senate seat if he comes from their own state itself. Sapagkat ngayon, nung nakalipas na eleksyon, nakita natin, sa buong Pilipinas, isa lang ang taga-Visayas ang nahalal. Franklin Drilon. I'm talking about the last elections. Only Franklin Drilon was elected senator from the Visayas. Wala pong taga-Samaranliti, wala pong taga-Cebu, Bohol, etc. Merong isang taga-Ilonggo provinces, pero wala din yung Mindoro, Palawan, wala silang representation. Pagdating sa Mindanao, sino ba ang mga, tatlo lang ang mga senador ngayon, ha? Manny Pacquiao, si Subiri at yung Coco Pimentel daw, ayaw ko kung sino yung anyway, tatlo. Now, you look at Manny Pacquiao, Southern Mindanao. Mick Subiri, Coco Pimentel, Northern Mindanao. Bangsa Moro, walang representasyon. That is so unfair sa tingin ko. Isa sa mga reason kung ba't may hinanakit sila sa kaluban nila na about discriminated kami by that provision.
Pero kanina, you will also agree with me na mayroong mga kandidato mananalo on a nationwide election rather than a federal area because bistado sila roon. Bistado sila, hindi sila mananalo sa locality. Pero pwede manalo on a nationwide scale.
That's also an additional reason bakit dapat federalism ang atayuran. In addition, ang aking proposal ay tag-aanim na senador bawat federal state. So if you are proposing 12 federal states times 6, that's 72. Bigyan mo pa ng anim na representation ng mga senador ang overseas Filipinos, Metro Manila, aabot ng 80. Masyadong marami sa tingin ng mga tao. But mga kapatid, yung 24 senators na sinusunod natin noon, panahon pa ni Quezon at Osmeña yun, good for the time when the Philippines only had between 18 to 20 million people. Ngayon, sobrang palaanan tayo. 110 million people na tayo. Therefore, sa tingin ko, we should revise the Constitution para madagdagan ang senatorial representation sa mga taong bayan. And I have some figures to add. Number one, for example, United Kingdom, England. Ilan ang population nila? 64 million. Ilan ang House of Lords nila? 797. Tayo, 110 million, 24 people, 24 senators lamang. France, 64 million people. Ilan ang senador ang mga higher, upper chamber nila? 348 senators. Tayo, 24. Paspasan natin, Thailand, 68 million people. Last year, 2 years ago, at nirevise nila ang kanilang constitution, and they added to their upper chamber representation, 250 ang senador nila ngayon sa Thailand. Ang population nila, 68 million lamang. Tayo, 110 million, only 24 senators. Now, finally, Australia, 30 million people. Alam mo ba ang sa Malaysia, Malaysia, 30 million people. Ilan ang senador nila? 70. Tayo, 24. You see? We need to revise our constitution, dagdagan ang mga senador.
Kaayik, anong tulong sa inyo niyan?
Well, ang problem namin dyan, Camelo, as long as we do not dismantle the monopoly of power, yung political dynasty, no? Yung political dynasty, anuman ang pagbabago ng pampolitikang istruktura will only worsen the concentration and the control of the economic resources. Ang tingin po namin, kapag hindi po nababago yung political economy kasabay ng pagbabago ng pampolitikang forma ng ating gobyerno, magiging regionalized lang ang power. And those who are in power currently sa mga sasabihing division ng regional states will be the ones surely to represent. No? For example, sa Mindanao, sabihin na natin, yung mga current existing congressmen and women ngayon, kapag nagbago sa federal form at magkakaroon ng federal state, we will still expect that these are the same people who will be elected in the federal states because they have still the same influence, power, and economic resources to control or not only control, to proceed with and surely win their seats.
Okay.
So, yun yung problema namin na kung baguhin natin, totoo, yan po ay karaingan na ngayon, it's a popular demand. Pero if hindi kasabay yung pag-address natin sa economic inequalities, economic distribution, are we expecting na mababago din yung upo?
Mm-hmm.
Kung hindi man ganitong naboboto ng mga kongresista ngayon, ano ba ang magkakaroon ba ng patas? Kung magkakaroon ng federal state, for example, Florendo, lalabanan ba yan ng isang magsasaka, isang simpleng sektor para makaupo ka sa federal state?
Mm-hmm.
Likewise, yung resources ba niyan, equal footing ba yan laban sa resources ng Florendo to win a seat
okay
in the federal state?
No, Dante, Speaking of Quezon City, a good example. How many districts do we have in Quezon City now? Six congressional districts. Bago pa man nagkaroon ng pang-anim na distrito, yung magagaling na konsihal ng Quezon City, nagbahay na dun sa mabubuong 6th district. Nang sa ganon, yung kanilang mga anak, kamag-anak, can run and become councilors for the district. Will that not happen under a federal system?
Well, kung meron nga tayong provision sa federal constitution, including the state constitution, about political dynasty. Kung maliwanag yan, maiwasan talaga yan. Melon, no? Tami siya sabi mo. You're so talking about facts. Oh, good example, no?
Example.
Dati-dati, may isa lang dyan, hindi ko nababot yung pangalan, isa lang siya, naging dalawa, naging tatlo, naging apat, naging lima, naging pito.
Bukas makaluwas, sila na may
bearing the same family name, no? Oh. Anyway, meron, if you don't mind, may aya, no? Na bakit kasi yung Senate, yung managit ni Kanene, ang aming panukala po is unicameral, hindi bicameral. Ang panukala natin, isa lang chamber, unit chamber, one chamber. Bakit? Experience ko bilang legislator. Kung anong ginawa sa House, napakaganda, napakaayos, preparado, brilliant. Pagdating sa Senado, as if you will start from square one or zero. Ulit, pag hindi niya nakaigi, you have the bicameral conference committee. And, I'm speaking for the record, Bella, sa bicameral, that is the most effective legislative body. Because the lobbies and other special interest groups can better operate.
How do you spell bicameral? B-U-I?
Melo, ikaw na bahala doon.
Sinabi na parang ganun.
No, kaya sabi ng unicameral, we've learned from our lessons. Kaya the interest of the people will be better represented and protected and pursued in a unicameral system.
Apo. Attorney, from the outside looking in.
This is again about the Senate. What will it look like, no? So Senator Nene maintains the same, but proposes that senators be elected per federal state. And then Honorable Congressman proposes a unicameral. Now, in the PDP Laban draft, which I advise you to look at, they follow Senator Nene's model. However, in their draft, the Senate has no lawmaking power anymore. So the Senate becomes the what they have is the power of assent. They give their confirmation for the law to be enacted. So they don't, they address your concern.
They cannot meddle anymore.
Uh-huh. So the lawmaking process is limited to the federal assembly, the envisioned federal assembly, and then that goes up to the Senate for their assent. They don't have any lawmaking power anymore.
But Attorney, you will also agree with me, there's this book entitled Power Play, that whenever something gets proposed in Congress, once it gets passed, no, you won't even recognize it because it's been watered down a number of times.
For sure. That is a reality that we face now. And that's the something that we should not forget when we think about amending or revising our constitution. The lawmaking process. If we allow that kind of a reality to continue, whether we're federal or not is irrelevant. We will still be churning out the same substandard laws that we have now.
Coming from substandard lawmakers, you mean?
Substandard laws, that's what I said.
Okay. I stand corrected. Questions from our colleagues from the media? Yes, please, yes. Identify yourself.
Yes, sir. Good morning. I'm Oscar Walter from GMA7. Nabanggit kayo na, sir, yung equality dun sa eleksyon. Is it possible sa isang federal government na maging state-sponsored yung kampanya? I mean, no politician or no candidate will be allowed to spend his own money. Yung gobyerno ang magsupondo para pantay-pantay yung exposure. Tapos, ang pinaka-role ng government is pakikilala ko ng klaseng kandidato ito based on credentials, yung kanya mga achievements. accomplishments, saka yung mga naabot niya. Is that Oscar, possible? Ano?
Oscar, maganda yung idea, pero paano yung mag-donate?
Yes, sir.
Hindi, hindi yung mag-donate. Mayroon mga tumatakbo, whether you like it or not, who run for the fund of it. Okay. Anyway, we will get there.
Well, Oscar, dati po, dating kongreso, may panukalang makabayan to level the playing field. Ngayon, may naipasa kami sa second reading, amending the election code with regards to the expenditures of candidates. And government, COMELEC, should supervise only the supervising authority that will allow yung propagation ng mga kandidato, advertisement, no? Hindi lang simple limit ng funds, yung piso kada poster. The COMELEC is given the sole authority to supervise the campaign, no? Yung kumbaga yung ay ang problema mo kasi diyan, Oscar, ay paano yung mga stations, yung mga media outfits that will offer advertisement for a certain fees. Kung hindi, kung kaya mong bayaran yun, you can avail of their airtime. Pero yung kandidatong mahirap, walang capacity yun. Yun yung isang problema. Now, in our proposal was, only the COMELEC. Yung COMELEC ang itatap ni itong major networks. Obligado, hindi sila maniningil. Part of the mandatory provision yan. And for the campaign period, ito lang yung airtime na ipoprovide, supervised by the COMELEC. Para yung mahirap at mayamang kandidato need not spend even a peso para i-campaign niya yung mukha niya or yung platform niya. Pero again, napakalayo ng current na in-approve ngayon. And they will still allow yung campaign sa mga media
na. Pero sir, again, under dun sa federal na kada federal state yung mga kandidato at hindi na national, mas posible yun.
Mas posible yun. Pero yun nga, yung problem, does the provision allowing contribution will stop? Kasi kung magpapatuloy yun, yung kandidato na may pera can still avail of the offers of media networks in the locality to campaign, to present their platform and their personalities. So, wala pa rin yung, hindi pa rin yung patas sa mga kandidatong walang capacity, financial capacity to buy such an airtime.
Okay. Kanin?
Yes.
Okay. Number one, dapat alalahan, we must always remember that democratic system is always evolutionary, not revolutionary. Ibig sabihin, dadahan. Okay, magpasa ng law. Kadaming batas dito sa Pilipinas, ang kulang ang implementasyon. Therefore, anong gusto na? Revolutionary government? No, sir. Dapat implement yung mga batas. At pag hindi implement, may pananagutan yung mga tao na hindi mag-implement. But the people must always be on top of the situation. Pag magpabaya ang taong bayan, okay, that's how it's going to work. The politicians will always dominate. Now, tungkol doon sa mga pobreng kandidato, aywan ko, kasali na rin yabang nito. When I run for mayor in Cagayan de Oro, panahon ni Marcos, I only have 2,000 pesos in my pocket. Eh, ba't nanalo ako? Because nakita ng taong bayan na, uy, maganda pala ito.
Sir, isang bagay, kaya kayo nanalo, walang picos.
Aside from that, ang gusto kong sabihin, let that money be the consideration of why you are pushing for an idea. Money will come later pag nakita ng tao na okay pala ito. Huwag unahin na, uy, saan ay kukulang pera, huwag na. Kaya nga yung mga kandidato na pobre, party list niya, among other things, ginawa ng gobyerno para yung hindi kaanong may kapasidad can still be a candidate assured of a place in our governmental setup. But remember, federalism is not the solution to all the problems of this nation. Dalawang pakay lamang ang tinatarget nito. Speedy development
anticipation of the Muslim unrest in Mindanao. Dalawa pa kayo.
Okay.
Other things, we have to live with that and tackle them as they come up.
Roll with the punches, so to speak. Roll with the punches. Questions from our colleagues? Because if there will be no more questions, we will say thank you and sing happy birthday. Yes, please. Pakilala ka muna.
Pansantos
ng
tribute, sir. Yung two-party system, sir.
Meron nga mga tao nagsabi sa akin, but hindi na lang tayo mag-two-party system. Mga kapatid, mag-two-party system tayo, sana napin ang PDP. Laban. Nationalist na liberal lang. Huwag! You allow the people. Kung anong partido gusto nila suportahan, let them support that. But that is how democracy works. Listen to the word, you know, the argument on the other side.
For the record, we are for a multi-party system, no? We've learned so much about the two-party system before, no? Alam niyo na nangyari, no? Hindi tayo masyadong gumana. Kaya it's about time to have this multi-party. Under our proposal, meron, no? It is a multi-party system. And, pasensya na, no? The parties will become regular parties if they wish so. Okay? Yan ang proposal namin.
Under sa resolution of both houses number 8, the PDP Laban proposal, still recognizing multi-party system. And party list system is being strengthened. Yung proposal din na they can participate as a regular party, not only a sectoral or marginalized representative. Wala pa akong nababasa mga proposal to return back to a two-party system.
To the earlier question about campaign reform, actually the PDP Laban Charter provides for state subsidies on political parties. So I also invite you to look into that. And they also have a strong party representation system for the federal assembly. So that reform counters. Possibly can counter dynastic elections, but only possibly. But as to returning to a two-party system, I don't think we can go back to that because we've been so used to a multi-party system. To limit our system to just two parties, I think it's not feasible at all.
Yes.
For curiosity, at the same time, participation to the discussions on federalism, who calls for public hearings and when do they take place? In the immediate future, you have already a set timetable.
Dapat nagkaroon na po ng agreement on both houses to adopt the resolution of both houses, it will be a constituent assembly. But for now, both houses, I presume, is conducting their own consultation. And in fact, every batches or clustering of articles to be amended, iniimbitahan po lahat sa committee ng Constitutional Amendments Committee, Good Governance and Committee on Local Government, nagkaroon na ng mga serye ng konsultasyon. Pero as to come up with, how to come up with a final draft para i-present sa plenary, ay hindi pa po umaabot sa puntong yun. So, I don't know sa development sa isang chamber, sa Senate, pero ito yung nangyayari ngayon. So, kaya nga, ang sabi ko kanina, medyo hindi aabot doon sa timeline dahil we will be having our break on the 15th. Most likely, by 2018, dyan pa matatalakay whether to finalize. Ano yung i-adapt? Kasi nga, mayroong maraming proposal. RBH number 8, may separate proposal doon. Manong Nene has a separate proposal. PDP Laban has a separate proposal. Ang grupo nila, Congressman Dante, mayroon din proposal. So, i-consolidate po yun. I-consolidate po yun, and I don't know kung mayroon ng body yung mga committees ba ng yung committee secretariat ba ng tatlong committee ito nagkaroon na ng meeting of the minds to present a final draft in consolidation of all proposal. So hindi pa namin nakikita yun kung meron man.
In case that happens, it will be 2018 already.
For lack of material time, talagang until and unless committee will still conduct consultation or even meeting even during the break. Pero remember Christmas break ito, I doubt if our colleagues will do such marathon hearings, no, or series of consultations.
It will be more expensive to rebook flights. So I heard.
Last point lang, Melo, no? In our movement, People's National Movement for Federalism, we have one specific proposal. Ano yun? We are proposing, instead of a Supreme Court Federal, a Constitutional Commission. And one of our proposed provision there is to empower the commission, Constitutional Commission, to review any organic proposed bill which will impinge on the Constitution para maiwasan na yung mga constitutional issues in the race pa sa Supreme Court. Of this time, we're proposing that that Constitutional Commission be empowered to automatically evaluate any proposed bills or laws that will impinge on the Constitution. So, tuloy-tuloy yung trabaho natin. Di yung may batas na, idadala na naman sa Korte Suprema like the RH law, di ba, no? Oh, nagkaroon ng TRO, napakatagal. But with this provision, Melo, may iwasan natin yun.
Okay. Yeah. Attorney, pitch for the book launch.
Yes, I'd like to invite everybody in behalf of the Ateneo School of Government. On Thursday, we will be launching our book entitled Federalism, Debate on Federalism, Citizens Handbook. So that's on Thursday, 10 a.m. at the EDSA Shangri-La Kamya Room.
Okay.
Thank you.
Last question from Tracy. Tracy,
I've heard the word used always, empowerment. It's about people empowerment. Pati nga criminal eh, empowerment na rin. Because of human rights issues.
Is that the point to be discussed?
The point is, are the people really empowered pagdating sa mga discussions tungkol sa good governance and ano? Kasi, meanwhile kami, we already suffer. Meron bang kayong ginagawa or have you looked into really na para ma-empower ang tao? Kasi wala naman kami pakialam sa ginagawa ng mga nasa ano.
That's a very hard question to answer. But in my experience, in the forums that I have attended, not all over the Philippines, but in Cebu, in Sarangani, and here in Metro Manila, I feel that the people are empowered. Empowered enough to question this idea of federalism, to question speakers as to why we should federalize. Will federalization lead to economic equality? So in that sense, I believe that people are empowered just by the process of understanding what we're going through right now.
Okay.
What is the percentage of the population knowing about federalism? Do you know that? Presentation tambay.
I cannot answer that. But that would be a good question to answer, maybe by the survey.
Maybe the lawmakers should know that.
No. Let's put it this way: we celebrated ASEAN's 50th anniversary 2 years ago. Nobody knew about ASEAN. Even Singaporeans never knew about it. So that's the point. It behooves upon people proposing for a federal form of government to really go out and discuss these issues with the people. The problem is, will the people be concerned? Because their concern is how to keep their body and soul together. Okay? Yes, Lingoy, I know you have some questions. Oh, no questions, okay. So I'd like to thank our friends who took time out to be with us. And let us greet Senator Nene Pimentel a very happy birthday. As we all, asan yung cake natin? Pakisuyo nga nung cake. Pakisuyo lang. Okay. And then, we will also include in our prayers the soul of Senator Planas, who was once our guest. She passed away recently and she was cremated and was not able to rest. So thank you very much. Have a nice day. Once.